Hi everybody. So in earlier videos, I talked about two of the three main types of studies done in psychology. We talked about descriptive studies and correlational studies. If you haven't watched them yet, definitely check them out. Today, we're going to talk about the third type of study, which are experiments. Experiments are important because they are the only type of study that has the ability to show a cause and effect relationship. Make sure you remember that because it's pretty important to know. As I mentioned in the other videos about psychological research, this video is going to give a general overview of experiments that is focused on what a student of a general psychology course needs to know, rather than an in-depth description of all the different types of experiments. Now, experiments, like any other study in psychology, is based on the scientific method. A key part of that scientific method is developing your hypothesis. We also need to think about who our experiment is designed to help. Who is the experiment designed for? Say, for this video, I want to look at whether or not using videos in college classes is more effective at helping students do better academically. Now, remember that the hypothesis is one sentence long, in an if-then format, and must be falsifiable. That means it has the ability to be proven to be wrong. That is important because we're doing the experiment to test the hypothesis. So if I wanted to see if videos are more effective at teaching college students, my hypothesis would be something like, if college students do better in classes that use videos in their curriculum, then students that are in those classes will have a better grades than students that are not. This is one sentence long. It is in an if-then format, which means if one thing is true, in this case, if students do better in classes that use the videos, then something else must be true. In this case, it would be have better grades. Obviously, the people that are going to benefit from this would be college students. Another way of saying this is that college students are my target population. A population is, by its very definition, very large. Because they're so large, it means that you can't really study all of a population. Just think about it for a second. There are tens of millions of college students just in the United States. So if I wanted to do this experiment in real life, there's no way I could get tens of millions of people to participate. Even if I could, it would be really expensive and really time-consuming to study tens of millions of people. The good news is that I don't have to. Because populations are so large, we have to pull a smaller group from that larger population. We call this group the sample, and it's composed of people who are volunteering to participate in the experiment. Not everyone that volunteers may be selected to do the experiment, though. It is always important to remember that your sample, the participants in your study, must reflect the larger population that your experiment is meant to apply to. That means for my little experiment here, the sample of my participants need to reflect all college students. This usually consists of things like sex, race, ethnicity, and age. So if 20% of all college students are black, then 20% of my sample need to be black. If 55% of college students are women, then 55% of my sample needs to be women. Generally speaking, the larger the population, the larger the sample. Some experiments, especially those for things like medications, also need to factor in more things like body weight, height, medical conditions, and many other factors, and those experiments usually have very large samples also. Once I have my participants and know that they properly reflect my population, I'm going to break them up into different groups. This has to be done through a process called random assignment. That means that you can't decide for yourself who goes into one group or the other. It must be left to chance. In the past, this could have been through something as simple as flipping a quarter. However, today this is usually done through computer programs. Using this random assignment, you are going to divide your sample into either a control group or an experimental group. Just like how the sample needs to reflect the population, each of these groups also needs to reflect that population too. There can be no differences between these groups. That's really important to remember also. Now, in any experiment, there's always going to be at least two variables that are being studied. If you remember from the correlational studies video, a variable is anything that can be measured. Well, in experiments, we have terms for these types of variables. We have the independent variable and the dependent variable. The independent variable is the thing that we're trying to see if it is effective or not. The dependent variable is the thing that we are using to measure the independent variable. Another good way of figuring out which is the independent and which is the dependent variable is that the dependent variable is always going to be the exact same with the control group and the experimental group. The independent variable will be different. The way I remember this is that the dependent variable is very dependable. It's always there. The independent variable is not. Now, I would like for you to take a few seconds and think back on that hypothesis I mentioned earlier. Pause the video and try to figure out for yourself what the independent variable is and what the dependent variable is. When you come up with an answer, press play again. I love doing this because it helps transform these videos from just being something you passively listen to something that really helps deepen your understanding and improve critical thinking skills. So I really hope you paused the video and took a few seconds to really think about that answer. The answer to my question is that the independent variable are the videos in the classes, and the dependent variable is the final grade. Now, remember, I said that the independent variable isn't the same with every group. What I mean by that is only the experimental group is going to get the independent variable. The control group is not. This is one of the reasons why you may hear that the experimental group gets quote unquote messed with. It means that it is the group that is getting something different. The control group is our baseline, or our group that is in its normal, unaltered state. However, both groups are going to get the exact same dependent variable. Just to recap here, the purpose of an experiment is that if the control group and the experimental group are identical and they are being measured the exact same way, then if there is a big difference to that measurement, it must be because of the independent variable, since that is the only thing that is really different between these two groups. In this case, that would be whether or not videos were included in the course's curriculum. So if my experimental group had higher grades, you can make an argument that it's because of the videos or the independent variable. One last thing to keep in mind. You will always have just one control group in any experiment. You also must have at least one experimental group, but you can have more than one. This is actually pretty common for experiments that involve pharmaceuticals because they may have one experimental group that gets a lower dose of a medicine and another experimental group that gets a higher dose. Just like with correlational studies, we can always have confounding variables that can interfere with these results. And usually experiments need to be replicated many times and show consistent results in order to be considered valid. I realize that you may not have an interest in conducting research, but it's important for everyone to have a good understanding of what goes into these types of studies because we're exposed to scientific information on a fairly regular basis. The COVID pandemic was a great example of this. It was also a great example of how people can manipulate data in science for personal or even political reasons. Being able to understand the basics of how research is conducted helps make us better, more informed, and critical recipients of that information, and less likely to be manipulated by others for ulterior purposes. And that's always a good thing. Thanks for watching, everybody.